Welcome to the Chesapeake Bay Foundation webinar, Finishing the Job, 2020 State of the Bay Report Explained. We hope that you're happy, healthy, safe, wherever you're joining us from today, and hopefully maybe enjoying some pre-spring weather after all the snow and cold we've all had. Thank you for joining us today. My name is Laura Luoma. I'll be the production manager today. A few quick housekeeping items before we begin. We are recording the webinar. For any reason you get signed off, we'll be sending this out after the fact, so don't feel like you're missing anything. It'll also be available on our website, cbf.org, in the coming days. We have return time at the end of today's presentation for questions and answers. You're going to hear a lot of great information from our speakers, and we encourage you to ask questions throughout the presentation. You don't have to wait till the end. If something piques your interest, please ask that. We'll be monitoring that. So that can be seen at the bottom of your screen. We do ask you to use the Q&A function and not the chat function, although we will monitor that as well. With that, we look forward to sharing our State of the Bay report with you today. And I am happy to introduce CBF's President, Will Baker, to start us off. Will.
Thank you, Laura, and welcome everybody. We have a just great interest in the 2020 State of the Bay report, so we're delighted to share it with you. There's some good news and there's some bad news, which is pretty usual when you're talking about the state of Chesapeake Bay. I'm joined today by Dr. Beth McGee, the Director of Science and Agricultural Policy at CBF, and Chris Moore, our Senior Ecosystem Scientist. CBF's mission, I think it's right up here above me, save the Bay. It's a three-word mission statement. But you know what we do differently is we follow the science to define what save the Bay actually means. Science tells us to succeed. There are three key elements. You reduce pollution, you restore the natural filters, things like forested buffers and wetlands, and you manage fisheries. Manage fisheries, Chris will be a little bit more scientific. I say managing fisheries means you don't take any more out of the bay in any given year than nature can put back. So here's the question, how's the bay doing? It's the question we get most often, and it goes back decades. The elevator answer, if you will, is it's getting better, and it's been getting better long enough so scientists believe it's a trend, but it's still dangerously out of balance. And nature abhors imbalance. Nature craves balance. So that's the best way I've come up with describing what's still left undone. Our 2020 grade is still a D plus, or a 32 on the numeric scale, and I'll get to that. But I, you know, my mom never, or my dad, would not have been pleased with a D plus. The good news is it's going in the right direction. So, but we got a long, long way left to go. So our immediate goal in the short term by 2025 is to get to a 40. On the numeric scale, and that would correspond to a C. That's starting to get within the realm of you know, you're not too embarrassed. You're getting up there. An A would be a 70 on the numeric scale. So let me explain. When colonial settlers arrived, the bay was a theoretical perfect. We know it wasn't, but theoretically, let's say that's as good as we could ever imagine. There were only 44,000 Native Americans living in the 64,000 square mile bay watershed. Now we're coming close to 20 million. So call that the theoretical perfect. If we could get to a 70, the collective we could get to a 70, we would call that an A. The 40 by 2025 is if all of the states in the watershed in the District of Columbia meet pre-assigned pollution reduction targets that they have agreed upon as part of an executive order issued by President Obama back in 2010 with 2025 as the deadline. We call it the Chesapeake Clean Water blueprint. Will we get to a 40? Well, stick around till 2025 and find out. The prognosis is mixed. Of the Bay watershed, six states, District of Columbia, 64,000 square miles, Maryland, Virginia, and Pennsylvania represent 85% of that watershed. So let's look at those three states. Maryland, Virginia have a plan. It's been approved by the federal EPA. If they can implement the plan, which is a big order, but if they can implement the plan, they will reach their 2025 deadline goals. Pennsylvania is another story. It has a plan, but even the plan doesn't get them to their agreed upon goal. And they don't have even close to enough money anticipated to implement the plan, which is not good enough. The Susquehanna River coming through Pennsylvania from New York supplies 50% of the Bay's fresh water. So the Susquehanna is critical. Pennsylvania is critical to the health of the tidal portion of the Bay downstream. In the past 4 years, and if we go back to the cover slide, thanks, Jessica. In the past 4 years, we've suffered a setback. It's the only way I can say it. We should be much further along. And I don't just mean Pennsylvania. I mean all the Bay states should be further along. But here's the problem. And you'll see some of this reflected in the actual metrics in the State of the Bay report when we get to those with Beth and Chris. The former administration, the Trump administration, reversed dozens of very fundamental environmental regulations and policies. Regulations that were under the Clean Air Act, the Clean Water Act, and other longstanding federal laws. These federal regulations are the foundation upon which the states build their environmental programs, whether it's pollution reduction, habitat restoration, fisheries management, whatever. So we're talking about very basic clean air and clean water protections critical to saving the Bay. Our first step, and again, I mean our collective first step, is to get those regulations and policies back in place. The Biden administration is starting down that path already. And we are guardedly optimistic with an attitude, if you will, of trust but verify. Now, obviously, the president is from a native state, from Delaware. So we believe and from past believe and think that he has a real interest in the health of the Chesapeake Bay. There was something else, though, that happened in the former administration's tenure. The first year, the president zeroed out the Chesapeake Bay program. This is the partnership between the states and the feds, down to zero. Congress, we have great bipartisan support in Congress, put the money back. And in the next three budgets, the president took it down by 90%. So every year he went after it, or the administration went after it, and every year Congress put the money back until finally Congress actually raised the appropriation. So that's good news, but we've got to protect that money during tough economic times and continue to have the bipartisan support that we've enjoyed. In September of 2020, CBF, the Maryland Watermen's Association, and a number of other partners sued EPA to try to reverse the programs and to try to force EPA to implement the Clean Water Act and make sure that all of the states, especially Pennsylvania, are participating. It must be a mandatory program, not a voluntary program. The blueprint is science-based. It has 10 years of buy-in and progress is being made. Now, call us idealists, but we truly believe that saving the bay could be the greatest environmental success story the world has ever seen. And think of the accomplishment saving a national treasure would represent. It will be a source of great pride to all Americans. And this is important, a critical step in addressing climate change. A healthy Chesapeake Bay is the best line of defense for our coastal areas against the impacts of climate change. Now, I think I've done enough pontificating. Let me turn things over to the people who really know what they're talking about, Beth McGee and Chris Moore, to get into the details of the report. Beth?
Great, thanks, Will. Appreciate it. Good morning, everyone. So I've had the privilege for probably more years than I care to share to be the coordinator for the State of the Bay report, which we're sharing with you today. So to go into what goes into that score that Will mentioned, the overall 32, we look at 13 different indicators spread across three different categories: pollution, fisheries, and habitat. Next slide, please. So really, reducing pollution to improve water quality is really the foundation of our efforts to save the bay. Next slide. When you look at the pollution indicators, you can see in 2020, we saw an improvement in all the indicators except for toxics, which remain the same. And I'm gonna go into a little bit more detail in each of these indicators. Next slide. Before I do that, I wanted to just set the context. All of our indicators are related to one another. As I said, reducing nitrogen and phosphorus pollution really is key to restoring the Chesapeake Bay ecosystem. That will help bring the fisheries back, but habitat also plays a role. So I wanted to go through a little bit of how all these indicators are tied together. All aquatic systems receive certain amounts of nitrogen and phosphorus pollution. So on the right-hand side, you can see a healthy system with reasonable levels of nitrogen and phosphorus pollution going into the system, feeding the algae, which are really the base of the food chain, and that in turn creates a healthy ecosystem. What we have in the Chesapeake Bay is on the left, and it's not unlike many estuaries and coastal systems, frankly, throughout the world, where we have too much nitrogen and phosphorus going into the aquatic system. What that does is it feeds nitrogen and phosphorus are nutrients. Farmers use them on fields to make crops grow. We put them on our yards to make their yards grow. When they get into aquatic systems, they are feeding the plants in these systems, particularly single cell plants called algae. When algae get a lot of food, they bloom. That in and of itself can be a problem. We have, for example, during the summer, we have instances of toxic algae blooms in the Chesapeake Bay. Dense algae can also shade the water. One of the really important ecological features of the bay are our underwater grasses. Grasses need sunlight to survive. If we have either algae blooms or sediment coming into the system, that's shading our aquatic plants, the aquatic underwater grasses, and they're either dying or not thriving. But more importantly, when the algae die and sink to the bottom, when they're decomposed, oxygen is used up. And animals that live in the bay, fish, crabs, and oysters need that oxygen. So what we end up with these algae blooms sinking to the bottom, decomposing, using oxygen, we have huge parts of the bay during the summer and the tidal rivers during the summer that are dead zones, that do not have enough oxygen to support aquatic life. And that's sort of the main systemic problem that we're trying to fix in the Chesapeake Bay. So the sources of pollution are agricultural sources, so runoff from cropland and farm fields. Sewage treatment plants is another large source of nitrogen and phosphorus pollution to the bay. And then we also have runoff from urban and suburban areas. Where habitat comes in, there's things like planting forested buffers along streams, maintaining and protecting our resource lands, so forest lands and well-managed farmlands. Those will help reduce pollution. So that's how sort of all our indicators are woven together and why we're looking at them in this way to really judge the overall health of the bay. Next slide. So the good news is that if you look at loads of nitrogen and phosphorus pollution in 2020 relative to the previous scorecard in 2018, the numbers improved. Okay, obviously they're still not where we want. They still are getting an F, but the numbers are moving in the right direction. So that's good news. Next slide. And in response, we actually saw an improvement in dissolved oxygen, again, because of this relationship between nitrogen and phosphorus pollution and dissolved oxygen. So that's more good news. Next slide. This is showing you the volume of the dead zone over time in Maryland. So in Maryland's part of the Chesapeake Bay, how much water over the duration of a summer did not have enough oxygen from 1985 up until 2020. And if you look at the size of the bar in 2020, it's actually among the smallest. In fact, it was the second smallest since they've been keeping track since 1980s. That's good news. A small bar means a small dead zone. And that was good news for 2020. One of the reasons for the small dead zone was weather. For example, wind can mix the dead zone and oxygenate water. Colder water holds less oxygen or holds more oxygen. And so weather played a role in this, but also scientists, when they released this information, said that our pollution reduction efforts are working. That one reason why we saw a small dead zone in 2020 is because what we're doing on the to implement the blueprint that Will mentioned is actually having an impact in a positive way. Next slide. The other piece of information that gives us optimism around the bay improving over time is if you look at the volume of the dead zone, again, from 1985 to the more recent time, you'll see that this is showing the volume over time for the whole summer. You'll see that it bounces around a lot. And what that is reflecting is wetter years bring more pollution. And so the dead zone tends to be bigger. Drier years, the opposite happens. But you can see that even though it bounced around over time we're seeing a decrease. That trend line is going in the right direction. We're seeing a smaller dead zone. Dead zones are ending earlier in the season and being smaller overall when you look over the long-term trends. And again, that's another reason why we have some reason for optimism that our pollution reduction efforts are working. Next slide. Water clarity is, again, important because of water clarity's effect on underwater grasses. We want clear water so our underwater grasses are thriving. We saw a slight uptick in this indicator score, again, reflecting pollution reductions, reduced pollution coming in 2020. Next slide. Toxic score did not change. There was a 2019 report that came out by the Chesapeake Bay Program, which is a federal state partnership working on bay restoration, that looked at toxic conditions in the Chesapeake Bay and came to the conclusion that things don't seem to be getting much better, but they don't seem to be getting much worse. However, the report also noted that our understanding of the fate and effects of toxic chemicals, particularly new and emerging ones that we don't really know that much about, is really hampered by limited information. So that's probably not the end of the story on toxics. Next slide. So as we move into our next habitat or next indicator group, I want to remind everyone that if you have questions, you can submit them into the Q&A tab, and Laura will be aggregating those questions at the end so we can answer them for you. So the habitat indicators we look at are ones that reflect that are really important to the health of the Chesapeake Bay. So forested buffers, wetlands, mentioned underwater grasses, and resource land. So let's look at each one of those. Next slide. So underwater grasses, I mentioned that they need clear water in order to survive. Well, in 2018 and 2019, we actually saw unprecedented levels of rainfall in this region. With that rainfall came a lot of polluted runoff, came a lot of sediment, and the water was really murky. And so next slide. What we saw actually in 2019, so this is showing you acres of underwater grasses throughout the Chesapeake Bay watershed. The way they get this information is they literally do aerial flyovers and map grasses. So this is showing you the acreage of underwater grasses over time in the Chesapeake Bay from the mid 80s up until 2019. And you can see that we were doing, from 2013 on, we were doing really well. Grasses were improving every year. That was really encouraging for a lot of us, but in 2019, they really took a hit. And what that is reflecting is the fact that we did have a lot of rainfall in 2018 and 2019, a lot of pollution, a lot of murky water, and the grasses went down baywide almost 40% between 2018 and 2019. In 2020, we believe that the evidence would suggest that the acreage has improved, but probably not to the levels that we saw in 2018, which is why our indicator score for underwater grasses dropped this year. Next slide. So forested buffers, this is basically planting trees along waterways. The many benefits include, as Will mentioned, their filters. They're filtering pollution from and preventing it from entering our waterways. They provide shade for streams. They're good for climate change in terms of sequestering carbon from the atmosphere and mitigating greenhouse gases. So there's a variety of environmental reasons why buffers are really important, not the least of which is that the states are really relying very heavily on planting forested buffers to achieve their pollution reduction goals under the Chesapeake Clean Water Blueprint. Unfortunately, if you look at the implementation of buffers bay-wide, implementation has not only decreased, but we actually believe we're losing buffers. Next slide. This is showing you, and yet another, I like data, you can tell I'm a scientist, I like data. This is showing you acres of forested buffers watershed-wide from the early 90s to 2019, the most recent year that we had data for. And you can see it peaked around 2010 or so, and then we've seen a drop off in buffers, which is concerning because the states have very high commitments in terms of implementing this practice to achieve their blueprint goals by 2025. The peak that we see here is actually largely driven by a federal program that's run by the U.S. Department of Agriculture that provides incentives for private landowners to put buffers in place. The program kicked off around the mid-2000s and really accelerated implementation, and that was a good thing. Unfortunately, there have been some issues in the last few years with the program, with the way the program has been implemented. And we are hopeful that the incoming administration, the new administration, will help reinvigorate and energize this program, which is really so critical to getting buffers on the ground. Next slide. So wetlands. Wetlands are another really incredibly important habitat in the Chesapeake Bay. Will mentioned the importance of restoring the bay as a first defense about climate change. Wetlands are a key function of that. As sea levels are rising, as we're seeing more severe storms, wetlands are providing a buffer between the water and the land that is shown to be really important to mitigate the impacts of weather events and things associated with climate change. They're also provide a nursery area for larval fish and habitat for a variety of different wildlife species. So they're really important ecologically for the bay. Unfortunately, there's really been no watershed-wide assessment of wetland acreage in more than a decade. So it's really hard to get a sense of sort of what's happening with wetlands in terms of losses and gains. However, what we can say with certainty, and Will also alluded to this, is that wetlands were one of the features that was threatened because of the rollbacks by the previous administration. In particular, there was the Waters of the U.S. rule that directly would have impacted our ability to protect wetlands was something that the former administration, the Trump administration, was undoing. And so we're hopeful that the current administration will reverse those rollbacks and we will be able to protect these really important ecological features. Next slide. The last habitat category are resource lands. So these are well-managed farmland and forest, natural open areas that are vitally important to water quality. There's no change in this indicator score, which reflects the fact that although we are losing forest and farmland to developed land every year, many of the states have actually done a good job of protecting these lands too. So it was one of those, we're losing some, but we're also gaining on the protection side. So overall, we did not change the score for this indicator in 2020. Now I want to turn things over to my colleague, Chris Moore in Virginia, to discuss the fisheries indicators, including the unprecedented drop in the rockfish score. Chris.
Good morning. Thanks, Beth. Appreciate the introduction. I'm Chris Moore, and I'm the Senior Regional Ecosystem Scientist here at the Chesapeake Bay Foundation, which means I get to work on various fisheries management and restoration opportunities throughout the Chesapeake Bay. So as Will kind of stated, there's some good news and bad news here, and the fisheries indicators are definitely a good example of that. The decline in rockfish, which is arguably the most important fin fish that we have in Chesapeake Bay from a recreational and a commercial fishery perspective, did see the largest drop we've seen in the last 10 years in any indicator. On the oyster front, we're continuing to work to meet really important goals set for 2025 when it comes to oyster restoration. The Chesapeake Bay Watershed Agreement set a oyster restoration goal of restoring oyster habitat in Chin tributaries by 2025, and we're continuing to make progress on that. And the Chesapeake Oyster Alliance, which CBF is a founding member of, has a goal of putting 10 billion new oysters in the Chesapeake Bay and its tributaries by 2025 as well. And then when it comes to blue crabs, a lot of conservation and fishery management programs that we started back in 2008 are continuing to help increase stability in that crab population. So let's get into the individual indicators, starting with rockfish. So rockfish obviously is a species that many folks in the Chesapeake Bay watershed had been concerned about declining over the last 10 years or so. And these concerns were brought to the forefront by the Atlantic State Marine Fisheries Commission in late 2019 and early 2020, when the stock assessment, or basically the population estimate, showed a very significant drop in that population and confirmed fears of a lot of us here in the Chesapeake Bay watershed. In this chart, the kind of bluish shaded area represents the number of adult female striped bass in the population. And that is the major indicator we use in order to judge the health of this population. And you can see that that has dropped by about 40% between 2013 and 2017. And a lot of efforts are going to get started here very soon. Some of them have already happened in order to help restore this population to the highs we saw in the early 2000s. The Atlantic States Marine Fisheries Commission, which is a cooperative of all the states along the Atlantic coast from Maine to Florida, is helping to really kickstart those efforts. And they were the organization that helped coordinate the restoration of rockfish in the late 80s and early 90s as well. All the states along the Atlantic coast took conservation, made changes to their management plans that hopefully will result in an 18% reduction in the catch of striped bass to help that fish start to recover in 2020. And those changes will remain in effect for 2021 as well. In addition, the Atlantic States Marine Fisheries Commission recently launched a public comment period on a complete update of the fishery management plan for rockfish as well. And we hope you'll participate in that process along with us. If you'd like to learn more about rockfish, we have an upcoming webinar on March 8th at 6:30 that will provide details for you in the follow-up email from this webinar. So moving to the other finfish indicator, the American shad, you can see, unfortunately, it's not a great story for American shad as well. And this has been, unfortunately, more of a long-term story. American shad, which I've provided a picture of there in the bottom right corner, is actually the largest herring species we have in the Chesapeake Bay. And though very few remember, it actually supported the largest fishery here in Chesapeake Bay for many, many years. Unfortunately, American shad, though, have had a number of stressors that have negatively affected their population. First, we started damming a lot of the spawning habitat for this fish, even going back into the 1700s and the 1800s. And then that nutrient and sediment pollution that Beth talked so much about further degraded their important spawning habitats over the years. More recently, we've had additional concerns about species like the non-native invasive blue catfish actually, unfortunately, eating the small shad when they're in the rivers and our creeks and other Chesapeake Bay tributaries prior to heading out and joining the coastal population of American shad that travel up and down the coast. And then last, this is a species also that restoration efforts, especially over the last year, unfortunately, have been negatively impacted by the pandemic, as a number of restoration programs, especially on the Susquehanna River, had to be completely shut down due to COVID protocols. So now moving into an area with a little bit more good news, oysters. Both Maryland and Virginia are continuing to see some success with oyster restoration, especially what we call the tributary level scale for that. And Maryland and Virginia, through that Chesapeake Bay Watershed Agreement, are both working on restoring five tributaries in their various systems. CBF continues to invest in new cutting edge technologies to improve the pace of oyster restoration as well. And so what I pictured here is our new mobile setting unit that's currently docked on the Lindhaven River down by CBS Brock Environmental Center that for the next 3 or 4 years at least, will hopefully be increasing the pace of restoration down in this area, especially. Somewhat like American shad, COVID did hinder some of our restoration programs, especially during the last year. But fortunately, the Chesapeake Bay Foundation, even during a shortened season, was able to plant 14 million oysters in Maryland waters. Here in Virginia, we actually had even some better news. One of our long-term partners in oyster restoration efforts, the Virginia Marine Resources Commission, actually constructed 21 acres of new oyster reef in the eastern branch of the Elizabeth River. This actually will become the sixth restoration tributary here in Virginia, so we're really, really excited about that effort. In addition, during the very long 2020 General Assembly session here in Virginia, the General Assembly put forth, or basically dedicated, an unprecedented $10 million in capital funds to oyster restoration efforts here in the Commonwealth of Virginia. And those funds will go a long way starting this restoration season to meeting our restoration goals here in the Virginia portion of the Chesapeake Bay. Moving on to blue crabs. Much like striped bass, probably one of the most iconic, if not the iconic fishery here in Chesapeake Bay. And you can see, we all love to see a bushel of blue crabs like you see there on the left. And many of us, if we're fortunate enough to be out on the waters throughout the year, we can see crab pots like you see there on the right in our creeks and in the main some of the Chesapeake Bay as the fishery for blue crabs. We'll get started in about a month here, both in Maryland and Virginia. One of the best pieces of news when it comes to the blue crab population is we're continuing to see stability in that population that we weren't seeing back in the late 90s and early 2000s. We still have a bit of room to improve. The target population for female adult blue crabs in Chesapeake Bay, and so blue crabs are somewhat similar to striped bass in that we measure the health based primarily on the number of adult females, has averaged about 165 million during the 2 years of the State of the Bay report. We have a target of about 215 million. So not bad, but we still have room to improve. Some other good news when it comes to adult males, which we've obviously started looking at more closely over the last couple of years, is their numbers have stabilized around 80 million during these past 2 years, which that's been good news. Will mentioned the importance of fisheries management in his remarks. And on the fisheries management front, this is another area where we're seeing success. Fisheries managers have done a good job making sure that the harvest has been below target levels over the last really about 10 years now. And excess harvest was really a problem that plagued this fishery in the mid 90s through the early 2000s. In addition, fisheries managers are implementing more and more electronic harvesting mechanisms that will give us better data in order to manage this fishery in the future. And then last, when it comes to blue crabs, talking about habitat is so important. Those nutrient and sediment reductions we're making in order to improve water quality are going to improve the number of underwater grasses in the Chesapeake Bay, going to help us improve our oyster habitat as well. And those habitats are so important to make sure we have a stable and robust blue crab population in Chesapeake Bay. So thanks so much for listening to the fisheries indicators of the State of the Bay report. I want to send it back to Will now.
Thanks very much, Chris and Beth. we've got a long way to go, but I don't know, maybe I'm just a hopeless optimist. I see a lot of things to be proud about and excited about. I'm really looking forward to the new administration. Administrations in Maryland, Virginia want to go in the right direction. Pennsylvania is a challenge. There is some good news there, but overall, it's really a question of funding. And one of the things we believe should happen is that the federal government should provide more assistance to the Pennsylvania farmers who are, quite frankly, lined up in waiting lists, trying to do the right thing, trying to get some cost share funding to help. So with that, I think I'm going to turn it back to Laura for the questions, which are in the Q&A. Laura?
Thank you very much, Will, and thank you to all of our speakers. A lot of great information. Just a reminder, you can take a deep dive on a lot of this stuff on our website, cbf.org. Plenty of robust scientific information for you. I think we'll start with a great question, given the current COVID conditions. Is it possible, Will, and this might be a good one for you, is it possible that less tourism and less recreational time on and around the waterways during the pandemic had a positive impact in 2020?
You know, that variations on that question have come through repeatedly. It's interesting that the questioner asks about tourism and recreational opportunities on the water. That would be part of it, but the way I think of it is the overall impact, the overall totality of human activity has clearly changed in the last 12 months. I think most people are driving less, we're flying less. And there is some anecdotal evidence that that has been good for the planet and therefore good for the bay. Air quality has in some places been shown anecdotally again to improve. The trouble with my scientific friends is they have to collect the data, analyze the data, and report the data. So you get about a two-year lag or close to it in terms of getting feedback on things like this. But anecdotally, it looks as if there may be some benefits, and we'll wait for science to tell us. The problem is that nobody wants COVID to continue. So it's simply an indication of how human activity can, in fact, affect the environment.
Thank you, Will. Here's a question about agricultural runoff. How big are the relative contributions of agricultural runoff, urban-suburban runoff, and water treatment outflows to the nitrogen and phosphorus pollution entering the bay? Beth, that might be your question, but let's see who wants to tackle that one.
Will, I'm sure, could answer it too.
Yeah.
Bay-wide, agriculture is responsible for about 40% or so of the nitrogen and phosphorus pollution. Sewage treatment plants are somewhere around between 25 and 30%, depending on what pollutants you're talking about. Urban and suburban runoff is more in the realm of 15%, 11%. For nitrogen, interestingly, about a third is coming from the air. And that's fossil fuel combustion, as well as ammonia emissions from livestock operations. So that's not true on the phosphorus side, only true for on the nitrogen side. Will, do you have anything to add to that? Corrections?
No, but I'll just jump off from that and say that one of the big strategies that has been put in place fairly effectively across the watershed that has shown improvement is upgrading sewage treatment plants. That is a technological fix. It's not inexpensive by a long shot, but most of the big municipalities and now the smaller ones are doing a relatively good job of treating sewage, and we're seeing the water quality benefits from that. Air pollution too, the Clean Air Act is a big contributor toward improved water quality. So the converse of that, when you undercut or reverse elements of the Clean Air Act, which certainly happened in the last 4 years, that had a real impacts on water quality as well.
And I would, another friendly amendment to Will, what you said is that the sources that we really need more progress on is reducing pollution from urban areas and suburban areas, as well as from agriculture. Many of the states are behind in those pollution reduction efforts from those sources. As Will said, the big success story is really reducing pollution from sewage treatment plants.
Thank you both. Okay, so this question has come up a few times now. The report highlighted the work we're doing to assist farmers with making better decisions for the Bay. But what is CBF doing, or what can people do to, what are CBF doing to educate homeowners on how to manage their gardens and protect the Bay? And then I guess also, what can we do, you know, as homeowners to protect the Bay?
I'll jump in, and then Beth or Chris, you follow. Everybody can come over to my house and look at my beautiful weeds. They actually don't look that bad, but putting less chemicals on your lawn absolutely affects and benefits local water quality in the Bay downstream. If you must have a very manicured lawn, then at least try to get soil samples and work with a professional, and tell that professional you want to use the minimum amount you can. But hey, come on over. My weeds look just great, especially in the spring when they're nice and green. In terms of how do we educate people, you know, I learned a heck of a lot from my two kids. Kids educate parents, and CBF educates students. We have the largest environmental education program in the country, 30,000 students each year in the field, on the water, when we're not under COVID lockdown. So we do a lot of that, but we also put out a tremendous amount of material with hints, things people can do as homeowners. Again, the bottom line for me is if you don't have to use it, and it is basically anything you're adding, whether it's a caustic cleaner, a pesticide, a poison, or a fertilizer, if you don't have to use it, don't use it. And that's good for your pocketbook as well. Beth or Chris?
Yeah, I wanted to jump in because, Will, this was actually your brainchild back in the day, is we have on our webpage a Bay Footprint Calculator that is sort of similar to carbon calculators, but it's based on nitrogen, and it includes what Will said: do you fertilize your yard? Do you have native plants or a yard lawn? How much electricity do you use? Because again, a third of the nitrogen coming from the Bay. How much do you drive your car? Even what kind of food do you eat? So you can use this calculator. It takes maybe 5 minutes to maybe 5 or 10 minutes to run, and then you can play games. Well, if I drove less, what impact would that have on my nitrogen pollution that would go into the Bay? And it's I think it's CBF/Bay Footprint. Is the way to get to the calculator, and it has some tips of how you can individually reduce your footprint. And the other thing that I also, when people ask that question of me, is that you can let your elected officials know that you care about clean water, whether that is your county council person or your senator at the federal level, and everywhere in between. The voices that we need to save the Bay is one of the most important things you can do personally to help us save the Bay. Chris, you want to top that?
No, but I'll at least take off from one thing you said. Your voice is important. Will talked a lot about our education program for students. We also have a Voices program, which is our adult education program. And we actually ran that through a webinar series this year due to COVID. And it's a great way to learn what you as a homeowner can do around your home, around your property, but also how to get involved, just like Beth said, and help us ensure that better environmental decisions are made and we get the resources made to make sure we're successful in this effort.
Fantastic. We can share that footprint calculator in our follow-up email as well, so people can get to that. That's a great idea, Beth. Thank you. So our next question, Pennsylvania, what is needed? What strategy, what needs to be done to get some progress going in Pennsylvania, bring that into compliance? Will, that you might want to tackle that one first.
Yeah, I mean, I don't mean to be glib, but it's money, money, money. The largest source, as Beth mentioned, of nitrogen and phosphorus is agriculture. And that's nowhere is that more true than in Pennsylvania. The good news is that pound for pound, improvements to agriculture is the least expensive way to get a pound of nitrogen out of the system. And it is good for the strategies to reduce nitrogen from agriculture are also good for the farmer. The bad news is they do cost money. And last I checked, none of my farmer friends are getting rich. So they need cost share funds, just as every other source of pollution across the board has received financial assistance in reducing pollution. Think of it from corporations to power plants to sewage treatment plants across the board. And Pennsylvania's House is very reluctant to appropriate the funds. The Senate is a little bit better. The governor has been trying, but the House is the roadblock. We have 10, 15 staff, full-time staff in Harrisburg. We're gonna continue to lobby in the Pennsylvania General Assembly. But what we think is needed, because the Bay is a national treasure, is for the federal government to help Pennsylvania and therefore help Maryland and Virginia downstream put in place, give them the cost share monies for the farmers to put in place the practices. And the federal farm bill has a tremendous amount of resources that could be put to this use. And I would submit that putting resources from the federal farm bill to use to saving Chesapeake Bay and helping our farmers is a much better use than many of the cost support and price support and pay not to plant and things like that for the mega farms in the Midwest that we see so much of that money going toward. So as Beth says, as Chris says, let your elected officials know at the federal level that saving the Bay is critical and money to Pennsylvania is absolutely essential to the long-term success of the Bay.
Thank you, Will. Okay, our next question. You've mentioned the Susquehanna and the pollution there. Exelon's contract for managing the Conowingo Dam is coming up for another 50-year renewal, and they are fighting efforts to clean up that water behind the dam. If they win, what is a plan B?
So little context, the Conowingo Dam, yes, the mouth of Susquehanna historically has trapped a lot of sediment and nutrients associated with that sediment and prevented it from going downstream into the bay. We have recently discovered that the dam is now full. And so basically what comes in goes out over the long term. And also that during storm events, stuff is scoured. Think about a bathtub and you put a fire hose in it. You're scouring material from behind the dam. We believe, and they believe, that Exelon is responsible for that scouring. They have not maintained, they've not dredged behind the dam, yet they're making money off of the electricity that it generates. And as was indicated, their 50-year permit is up for renewal. And we were hopeful that there would be some mitigation placed into their permit that would require them to offset some of these impacts of the scouring and downstream effects on nutrients. And there's other impacts too. Fishman mentioned fish passage is a huge issue for dams, including Conowingo. So we are still hopeful that Exelon will want to come to the table and do be a good corporate citizen and mitigate for their downstream impacts on water quality. But in lieu of that, the states have collectively gotten together and developed what they are calling a Conowingo Watershed Implementation Plan. So they've come up with a strategy for where they would do pollution reduction activities that would help mitigate for the lost trapping capacity at Conowingo. Now, how that's going to be paid for is a big question mark. They they know where they want to do work, but they don't know how they're going to pay for it. And so that we're tracking that. I don't think money is going to fall out of the sky. So that sort of is the plan B, if you were, is that the states are working together with hoping either pooling their funds or maybe getting some federal assistance.
I'm going to move off of Pennsylvania for a second and into something that I know is very important for a lot of folks, climate change. What is the overarching message for the state of the Bay and climate change? And what effect is this going to have on our ability to save the Bay?
I'll do the simple answer, Beth, and then you expand. Beth mentioned this in passing, but it's so basic. Warm water holds less oxygen, and warmer water is one of the most fundamental aspects of climate change. The other thing is more storms relates to Conowingo and the Susquehanna, but to the other rivers that come down the bay, because stormwater carries pollutants, more impact on shorelines. So every aspect of climate change makes saving the bay more difficult. But on the other side, a saved bay, a more healthy bay, a more resilient bay will help reduce the impacts of climate change on coastal areas. So Beth, you know this chapter and verse.
Yeah, the only thing I would add is we're already seeing those impacts. We're already seeing warmer water. We're already losing shoreline. We're already seeing more severe storms. So we know even by 2025 that we're going to have to do a little bit more pollution reductions to offset all of those negative impacts. And the other thing I would say is a flip side of your coin, Will, about the increased resiliency is that things that we do to save the bay are also helping mitigate climate change. Planting trees, having farmers do plant cover crops. There's hard to point to any kind of practice that we're not doing that doesn't have dual benefits to both water quality as well as reducing greenhouse gas emissions.
Great, thank you both. A little nuts and bolts question here. When we conduct our reviews for this report, do we sample different areas of the bay and average those results? And can we target our treatments at those areas in most need of help?
So we don't collect any data. We are using data that is out there. And the good news is that the Chesapeake Bay is, we have great scientists here, great research organizations. So we have a lot of information at our access that's publicly available. So we, you know, Chris mentioned some of the databases that he looks at for the fisheries indicators. For the indicators that I look at, there's the Chesapeake Bay program has a bunch of information. So we don't collect any information ourselves. We use what's out there and we do aggregate it. It's, you know, we're doing a bay-wide look. We're not looking specifically at different rivers, for example. Although I'll give a little shout out to University of Maryland also does a report card every year, and they do look at different river systems and grade them individually. And so that might be something for this person to take a look at.
Yeah, and I'll just add on the fisheries front, there are some incredible data sets there. I didn't put up the data set from the Blue Crab Survey, but the Winter Dredge Survey, which is just finishing up this time of year, gives us regional information as well. Also, there are a lot of oyster surveys that actually can help us with the fisheries management piece that Will talked about in terms of where we allow fishing to take place or maybe don't allow it in some given year, but also allow us to target some of our restoration efforts because we know those areas are going to naturally seed with new oysters. We tend to call that spat set. And so we can use nature's helping hand when it comes to targeting some of our restoration efforts as a result of that data.
And Laura, I just happened to notice a question that can be a quick answer in the chat about is the oyster effort for the benefit of filtration or for commercial interests and those of us who enjoy eating oysters? The answer is yes and yes. The oysters are akin to the coral reefs of the Caribbean. They have multiple benefits besides filtering. And you know, if you ever want to give Chris Moore a call and he could talk to you for an hour about the benefits of oysters. But it's also important to help support the culture of the Chesapeake and the working communities that do rely on commercial harvests, as well as, of course, keeping the pressure on for the harvests to be sustainable. Back to that concept of not taking more than nature can put back. And I think eating oysters is a great thing to do, and it expands the constituency for saving the bay. Literally, Chesapeake Bay oysters travel all over the country.
I think we all can agree. We love Chesapeake Bay oysters. Now I'm getting a little hungry. Here's a quick question. What does CBF have planned for headwater areas in Virginia, like the Shenandoah Valley and Augusta County area? We have a lot of tree activities in Pennsylvania, obviously, but what about Virginia?
Chris, you know that one.
Yeah, so we have an agricultural restoration team that works in the headwaters area, and they are focusing a lot on buffer implementation in those areas. That's been, as Beth said, an area where we need to increase the pace of restoration. So they're working a lot with farmers to find those areas that we can plant buffers. They're also working on making sure we keep the cattle out of streams. Another incredibly beneficial process is making sure that farmers can be productive, but they can be productive without having those cattle basically water themselves and go back and forth between the streams and things like that. So we're really excited about those opportunities. Another thing that we're working on, and this goes to the climate change piece, to make sure we keep more carbon basically in the soil, is moving to rotational grazing type systems so that farmers can grow all of the forage they need for their operations on their farmland, use those areas to be grazed throughout the year. And so they're not having to import basically forage from other farms as well. And so that's another thing our agricultural restoration staff are really excited about out in the headwaters of Virginia.
So Laura, I think we're coming close to noon, and like you said, people might be getting hungry. I'm so old and I've been doing this for so long, I find myself more and more telling stories about the old days. I'm going to tell one story about the old days that is very much relates to what Chris just said about fencing cattle out of streams. I was at a bay reception, and I was talking, I was probably 30 years old. I was talking about how keeping cattle out of streams is good for the cattle, and it reduces hoof infections and udder infections and mastitis. And I was sort of out there. I'd read that somewhere, but I really wasn't on firm ground. I'm usually not on firm ground, actually. And the guy standing next to me was about 6'6", maybe 250 pounds. And he goes, "I'm a large animal vet." And I went, "Oh my God." He said, "Mr. Baker is exactly right." And I went, "Oh." And then he went on to explain all the benefits to cattle if they're not allowed, and to the farmer's bottom line, if they're not allowed to wallow in the streams all summer long. And so it's one of these strategies which is really good for water quality, really good for the animal in this case, and really good for the owner of that animal. So thank you all very, very much. We really appreciate it. Keep an eye on our website for future webinars. You heard Chris mention one. We're doing this more and more. I think this is one of the great benefits of COVID is that it has taught us that we need to go to these sorts of virtual meetings to get the word out and to provide information to our supporters. So we're very grateful. Thanks to Chris and Beth and all the staff who work behind the scenes. Laura, thank you. With that, I think we're done. Stay safe, everyone.